went down front still talking about Sunday night. So I know we're happy to be in the house of the Lord this evening. If you will, take your hymn book and turn to page 210. Page 210, Joy Unspeakable. We're going to do the first, the second, and the last verse. On the first, I have found His grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free as free indeed. In His joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. In His joy unspeakable and full of glory, all the heaven has ever yet been told.
On the second,
I have found the pleasure I once craved. It is joy and peace within. What a wondrous blessing I am saved from the awful gulf of sin. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable.
Pastor comes. Brother Danny Hawkins, would you lead us to the Lord in prayer?
Dear kind Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord Jesus, for an opportunity to be here in the house of God. And as the song director said, we was talking about the testimony service Sunday night. I really enjoyed that.
Amen.
I like to hear people brag on Jesus.
Amen. Lord,
thank you for all you've done. We pray, amen, Father, that you might get honor and glory tonight if anyone's here that don't know you as a free pardon of sin. This might be that service that they'll turn loose and accept you into their life, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Wave at somebody. We're glad to see you scattered out throughout the church and the balcony. We appreciate everybody being in the house of God tonight. And if you're visiting with us for the first time, hold up your hand and the ushers will bring you a card to fill out. And they want to pray for Master Clubs down in the other building, that God will bless the workers and the children down there. And then remember, Sunday school, Sunday morning at 10 o'clock, everybody try to be here. I'm telling you, it'll be worth your while to take a little extra time and come to Sunday school. I believe God will reward you greatly, spiritually. And that's what we're looking for. We want to grow in the Lord. So be sure and remember that. We want to read the prayer list off. Jeremy and Jennifer Wakefield, Ann Kay, Johnny Hembry, Nick Papala, Danny Black, Rita Cantrell, Brenda Alexander, Carol Clark, Loretta Fowler, Roy Pettit, Kathy Pettit, Zelda Bishop, D. Hall, Sybil Kelly, David Swanger, Walter Brookshire, Scott Wakefield, Jack Thomas, Judy Moody, Heather McKinney, Louise Carlton, Catherine Davis, and Catherine got her a kidney, by the way, and we don't know the full results of that yet, but it sounds good. Sounds like God's really being with her there. And then Eric Stevens, Sidney Kleiman, Stephen Wakefield, Jimmy McCall, Butch McCones, Hazel Thomas, Randy Key, Kristen Brown, Eunice Pridmore, Jimmy Thompson, Carol Center, and Mary Dan Kay. All right, ushers, you come. We'll receive an offering, and this will go toward the sign. Thank you for backing the church during the week we had to shut down. You stood by. We appreciate it, church. God bless you for that. Jack, lead us in a word of prayer.
Our precious Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to you tonight, we come, Lord, with thanksgiving in our heart just to praise you for what you've done for us, Lord. And Lord, we just ask that you just be with that long prayer list our pastor just read off. Lord, you know each name and each need on it. And we just ask that you meet their needs according to your riches and glory. And we'll praise you for that. Be with the little folks downstairs and the workers down there, Lord. And be with our choir and Brother Lyle as he leads it, Lord, our musicians. Father, come as our pastor comes here in a few minutes, just be with him and help him to preach, Lord, like it might be his last sermon upon earth, Lord. But we pray, God, that you just give him many, many more sermons. We just thank you again for our pastor and for our church, Lord. And thank you now for what we're about to receive. Be used for your glory, and we'll praise you for it all. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
too far to look back again. There is nothing behind me. All the treasures I used to love have all faded from view. There's a new day ahead.
Hymn book one more time and turn to page 225. Page 225, Showers of Blessings. I'm enjoying the Showers of Blessings tonight. We'll do the first, the second, and the last of Showers of Blessings.
Sound of the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Y'all singing tonight like you really mean it. I believe you do. And I appreciate it so very much. It's a blessing to my heart to hear you sing like you have tonight. I want to turn to John chapter 3, verse 19, for a verse or two here tonight for just a few minutes. John chapter number 3, this is on page 1118 in the old Scofield Bible. And this is John chapter 3, verse 19. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For every one that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. Light is come into the world. That is a fact. Praise God, this is what keeps me going. This is what keeps you going. In a day like we're living right now, and in all these years that I've been here, I've never seen a darker America than right now. I've never seen it darker than it is right now. I watch all the news that I can, not because I enjoy it, but because I want to educate myself in what's going on, and I want to see what people say and what they believe and what they're trying to do and what they don't know how to do. I'm learning a lot about people by watching all of this. But as I watch it, I see that our world is a dark world. It is dark because men's hearts are darkened. They don't know the Lord. In Psalm 112, verse 4, under the upright, there ariseth light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion and righteous. Boy, what would we do without Jesus? I wouldn't even want to be here without Jesus Christ. I'm serious, as I know how to be. If without him, without his comfort, without his blessing, without his love, without his grace, without sitting here thinking about him, as y'all sang about him tonight, and thinking about that great Savior that is soon coming, hallelujah, in this world of darkness, my heart is enlightened. And my friend, we will definitely be afflicted in this life as Christian people, but we will be comforted. We go through many things that will cause us a little bit of problems in this life, but we never miss the Comforter. He's always there. He's the God of all comfort. And then we shall have our share of troubles in this life, and we all sitting here know that very well, but we will always feel loved. You know, Leon just sang about it, and I'm talking about, and they sing about it, and I'm talking about it, the love of God. No matter what the circumstances are in us and around us, we know we're loved, because God can't hate us, he can't despise us, he can't lose us. He can't let us go. And then we shall experience our part of the dark world that we live in. It's all around us. But we shall have the light of life in us all the time. That doesn't leave. It doesn't darken. The light shines brighter. And my friend, it's more well seen whenever it gets really dark. Now, I'll tell you, if you want to see what I'm talking about, you could turn all these lights out right now, and it'd be dark, totally dark in here. But you could strike one match, you'd see that match. You could see that light from every direction in this building, and it's a big building for one little match. But one little Christian can put out some light in a dark world. So instead of us cursing the darkness, let's light a match, let's light a candle. Let's really get down to business and let our light shine for the glory of God. Now we shall serve God through it all, and of course retain our joy. And what a really good thought this is, that joy is down deep in our heart and cannot be taken out by the darkness that is all around us. What is really set forth in this scripture that I just read? First of all, we have a communicated declaration. Our scripture says, light is come into this world. Now, that's a fact, so we stand on that. So if you don't enjoy the light, you don't experience the light, that's your own fault. because light is come into this dark world. Praise his holy name. Now, the true light referred to here is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. He is declared to be the light of the world. In John chapter 1 and verse 4, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. In John chapter 1 and verse 9, the Bible says that was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Not every man without exception, but every man without distinction. And grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. When sinners are convicted of their sins, and of course it seems hopeless that they, can't get by, can't get things straightened out or get happy or have a happy day, then something happens. They hear the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, some people don't want to hear it. They refuse it when they do hear it. But some of us, we heard it, and we were glad to hear it because that made our spiritual ears perk up whenever we heard there's a way out. There's a way out of all this trouble. Trouble everywhere, darkness everywhere. But there is a light in this world. I want you to know by streaming or here in this building tonight, there's a light that is shining all the time. So when sinners are convicted of their sin, and it's a heavy time, but they hear about Jesus Christ and how that he can take their sin all away and set them free. Now, there's no greater message in all the world than that. People stood here Sunday night and testified, talked about what Jesus had done for them. I couldn't hear everybody clearly. I couldn't understand everything everybody said, but the Holy Spirit was blessing me every time somebody stood up because I knew what you were standing for. You were trying to tell what Jesus did for you. You were trying to tell how great God is. And I want to say, my friend, I didn't plan to get up Sunday night and testify. I didn't plan to have a testimony meeting. That was not even on my mind when I walked up those steps. It just came on. And, brother, people were enjoying that. I've already had about 4 or 5 people to come to me tonight and tell me how much they enjoyed that and how they were blessed. Well, brother, the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let us say so. Let us tell people. Let's tell each other. Let's fellowship around the Lord. Let's give God all the glory and praise him for his unspeakable gift. Now, what a delightful message. This is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. The Holy Spirit opens the heart of that sinner like it did Lydia, the purple. He opened her heart where she could hear and receive the things that Paul and those were preaching. Now, we all sing tonight. We all sing because we're happy. We all sing because we have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. It never gets old. It rejoices my heart every time I hear anybody say anything about Jesus Christ and not derogatory. I'm talking about, and old Paul said some of them didn't talk, favorably toward him, but he said, I rejoice that Jesus was named. His name was brought up. And I tell you, there can be anything going on anywhere at any time. And I tell you, when I hear the name Jesus, I turn to see. I turn to see what's going on. I want to hear what they got to say about my Lord. And I want them to say things that are right. I don't want them to say anything against him. I'm jealous for him. I get righteously indignant when they put him down. Don't ever put my Savior down in front of me because I'll tell you something. I'll tell you, my friend, he's the greatest friend this old boy has ever had. He's done more for me than anybody in the entire world. And I love people, everybody. What is this light? The light of life. In 2 Timothy 1:9, the Bible says, who hath saved us? Didn't say who will save us, but said who hath saved us. You're already saved. Boy, howdy. Boy, howdy. That's an old farm word we used to say, boy, howdy. Old Ralph Sexton Sr. said, old boy up in the mountains got saved. Said, boy, he got in. He got all the way in. And old country boy, old mountain boy, said he was so happy about it. And instead of saying he didn't know how to say glory, hallelujah, he jumped up and said, hot dog. He said, boy, that boy was happy. And then he'd tell other stories like that where people, ignorant of the scriptures and didn't know about shouting and glory and One old boy got saved. They said, "Did you really get saved?" He said, "Yeah, I swear to God I did." Hey, now you say, that's not good stuff, but brother, God understands every bit of it. God knew what he meant. And God is a God that understands more than you do and more than I do. I'm glad God overlooks our faults, overlooks our ignorance. Now, he's not wanting us to remain willfully ignorant. He wants us to learn better, and I'm sure they taught these guys better words to say than hot dog and swear to God. And I know they taught them that. But whenever you don't know anything, but just I'm happy, I'm glad, I'm full of joy for what God has done for me. And so he says right here, "He that hath saved us and called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now manifest by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel." Now, this truth has been absolutely declared, that Jesus is the light. So we have right here this truth, and it has been declared. So we have a communicated declaration. But then we also have a continual darkness. Darkness is still here. Although I'm in the light, although I have joy down in my soul, darkness is still in our world, and men are still in darkness tonight. Men love darkness rather than light. That's the reason it's still dark, because men don't love the light. And my friend, when people live in sin, they go where it's dark. I know back whenever we were in sin, we didn't go to a bright, lighted building like this one is and have our dances and drink our beer and do our ugly stuff. We'd go to a dark, dimly lit place with smoke all through that place and people smoking and people dancing and people doing, hey, a place of darkness. We didn't want all of our ugliness to be exposed, not even there. But brother, let me tell you something. Whenever you get saved, you don't want to go to that place. You dread that place. You hate that place. It's not for you. But you love to come into a beautiful church, praise God, and where the lights are on and everybody's seen. You can see everything about everybody. You see the saints of God sitting around. And everybody's happy in Jesus. Everybody's glad to be in church. Praise God and the Lamb forever. And think about the seriousness. Now, a lot of folk in darkness tonight, they don't think about the seriousness of sin and the situation that they're in. They don't realize what a serious situation they are to be living every day in a lost condition. Now, light has come into this world of darkness, but men love darkness. A place of darkness and a place of death. That's what it is. The light reveals Jesus Christ and his eternal life. So there's a contrast. Sinners without Jesus are living, my friend, one step away from hell. You and I that are saved by the grace of God are living one step away from heaven. The best thing that could ever happen to a saint of God when he dies is to wake up in the arms of Jesus. Now, you think I'm making it up or you think I'm trying to build it up and make it something it isn't. The Bible tells us that the moment we die from this life, when we leave this life, to be absent from this life is to be present with the Lord. So there's another promise, 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 promise. We are his and will always be. Now, when we see Jesus, we see the Father. He said that, and when he was here in a body. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And we learn of God's love and God's wisdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. And so we learn of the hopelessness and helplessness of sinners to save themselves. We realized that. We tried good things. I mean, we did. When we were sinners, we tried to do good many, many times. We turned over a new leaf. We started going to church. We'd go to this church. We'd go to that church. We even got talked into joining several of them. Got baptized in water. We went through all of that trying to be good, trying to get rid of that old ugliness in our life. But it didn't work. It never worked. We still were bad. We still went right back to the bad places. We still did the bad things. We couldn't shake it. We couldn't get rid of it. We had a desire, but we didn't know how to do it. But I'll tell you one thing. When Jesus found us, thank God, and he showed us the light. He showed us he was the light. He showed us we could get rid of all of that anguish, that frustration, that misery, that depression. You can get rid of all of that if you'll come to me. And brother, we came. And how glad we were to come. I'll never forget the message that was preached that night. I don't know all the words, but I know what it was about. Your name can be in the Lamb's Book of Life. You can know that your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. And boy, I'll tell you, that sounded good to me. I thought, good night. If I knew my name was in heaven, if I knew that, if I really knew that, I wouldn't worry about much other stuff, because that'd be all I need to know. If I'm going to die, I'll know I'll be in heaven. Because let me tell you something. To lay on a tar and gravel road in Simpsonville, flat of your back with a broken shoulder lying beside you, off your body, but except the meat holding it on, and you're thinking about my dying, and the black mountains are coming in. I don't want to die like this. And brother, listen, I went on 5 more years after that before God ever really stopped me and said, boy, I want you, and I mean for you to get saved. Boy, I tell you, I was under such conviction, I said, I got to get saved. And I did. And I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. So we leave. We leave our old sin behind. And then we start learning. We start learning of God's perfect holiness in contrast to man's imperfections and his sinfulness. We see now what's wrong. I was a sinner and I couldn't save myself. But Jesus was a Savior that could save my soul. And I saw that. And we do thank God for the light that has come into this world. With all of that and all that God has done for helpless sinners, they continue in darkness, some of them. Many people are continuing on in darkness because men love darkness. Shame, isn't it? Sad commentary, but it's true. Now, with all that God has done, man still says no. And that's just unbelievable. But I guess all of us did that for a good while before God really got us. Now, this is darkness of a Christless life. Think about it tonight, church. You and I are saved tonight. We know Jesus is our Savior. But think about a life without him. That would be a terrible thing, wouldn't it? Well, that's the way it was before we got saved. So this is a darkness of a Christless life. And this is a darkness of ignorance. In 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 6, the Bible says, for God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So this is a darkness that is a Christless darkness. This is a darkness of ignorance, but it's also a darkness of sinful pleasures. Now listen, a lot of things we do to have pleasure is not sin. And I'm not trying to put that down or discount it. It's all right to have pleasure in this life. But some of us have pleasures too much because it becomes our God. And then sinners that are lost, they keep on looking for more pleasure. They can't be satisfied. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, the Bible says, in whom the God, with a little g, of this world, has blinded the minds of them that believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Now, this blindness by Satan keeps souls from seeing the seriousness of dying in sin. You talk to people and they don't even care. They're not interested. Well, what if you die right now? Well, I just go to hell. I used to work with a man and I'd say over and over to him, when I'd witness to him, I'd say, what if you were to die like this? I'd just go to hell. Boy, just unconcerned as they can be. But I tell you, it takes the Holy Ghost to get a hold of a heart, because that old natural man doesn't want to get saved. And let me tell you something. You don't want to get saved, naturally speaking, as a lost person. You don't have any interest in getting saved yourself, not yourself. And the devil doesn't want you to get saved. He wants to keep you blinded so you'll go to hell. And the demons don't want you to get saved. Well, who in the world's going to interest me in my soul? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. He's the one that makes you interested in getting saved. He's the one that opens the Word to you. He's the one that opens your heart where the Word can get in, and the Word is sharper than any two-edged sword. And so why do sinners continue in darkness? Because men love darkness. Now, evil men enjoy pleasures of sin so much that they don't want to give it up. And they can't see why they should give it up. Why should I give up my drink and my beer? What's wrong with that? I don't hurt anybody. If I hurt anybody, I hurt myself. I don't hurt anybody else. I've heard every kind of excuse in the book why people want to hold on to their darkness, hold on to their sin. Now, the depraved nature of man craves sin. Oh, that old nature, that old flesh craves the sin. Now, men have increased in their sins, and they can't get enough of it. Now, we have a communicated declaration. We have a continual darkness, but then we have a corrupt desire because their deeds are evil. You know why they love darkness? Because their deeds are evil, and the flesh is just eating it up, just enjoying it. And the flesh doesn't want to give it up. While men are in darkness, they desire more and more evil. What else can I do to satisfy my flesh? Now, they resort to shameful things. The Bible says over in Jeremiah 6:15, were they ashamed when they committed abominations? He says, no. Nay, they were not at all ashamed. Neither could they blush. We're living in that day. People can't blush. They can commit any old sin, any perverted act, and it never make them blush. God said that's the way people are. Therefore, they shall fall among them that fall, and the time that I visit them, they shall be cast down, saith the Lord. And time's already run out. Well, let me say this. We have this communicated declaration. We have this continual darkness. We have this corrupt desire. And we have a condemnatory danger. This is the condemnation, he said. Men who choose the darkness over the light are justly condemned. The Bible says over in John chapter 3, verse 17, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So it is sinners' choice. Sinners are willing to sin and go right on rejecting Christ and not believing in him. They are justly condemned, justly. God's not doing anything against them. God's giving them the chance like he gave you and me. In Hebrews 10:26, for if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. Now listen, everybody. While we still have the light, believe on it. Receive it. Receive it into your heart. If you're by streaming there and you see the light now, you see that it's Jesus, let him come in and be your Savior. Go to heaven, praise God. Don't go to hell. Why go to hell? You don't want to be there. When you get there, you'll be sorry because you'll be there forever. You don't have to go to hell. Don't have to go. You can be saved right now in a second if you let Jesus come into your heart. John 8:12 says, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life, eternal life. Let's stand to our feet. If you're not saved, for God's sake, give your heart to the Lord Jesus and be saved. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and for getting us through this day and letting us be able to be in church tonight for just a few minutes. I pray that you'll bless us this week.